So thank you all for being here today for our happy hour. We are going to be discussing this amazing book, The Promise of Access, by Dan Greene, UMD iSchool's own. Dan is a faculty member in the iSchool, and we're very excited to have a lovely panel of folks here to discuss the book and some of the topics that Dan covers in the book. Just a kind of overview of how things are going to go. Dan's going to share some of his thoughts about the book first, and then we're going to hear from our three panelists, Dana Boyd, Steve Jackson, and Lilly Irani. I'll introduce each one of those three before they give their thoughts on the book. We'll have a bit of a conversation between the panelists, and then we'll open it up to questions from the audience. At any point, if you have questions, feel free to drop them in the chat and we will get to them. When we open up to the wider Q&A, I believe you should also be able to raise your hand at that point, but maybe you have some questions, thoughts, comments as we go along. We'll get to those, so just drop them in chat. So with that, why don't we have Dan share some of his thoughts about the book, you know, motivation, how he got there, any other thoughts he might have. So Dan, take it away.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Jessica. And thank you everyone for coming in today. This is an amazing crowd. So I thought I was going to maybe talk about like some high level goals that I had for the book and introduce some of the themes that are in there for folks that haven't read it yet, because it's only been out for like a month. So book is The Promise of Access, Technology, Inequality, and the Political Economy of Hope. You too can purchase it for 20% off using the code GREEN20, my last name, number 20, at penguinrandomhouse.com. And I'll put that in the chat afterwards. It's based on years of ethnographic fieldwork in different DC institutions that turn the problem of poverty into a problem of technology. And I want to first thank Mia Hinkle and Sarah Grun for helping out with publicity and setup here, and to a set of thinkers, Jessica, Dana, Lily, and Steve, who I deeply admire, for giving me the gift of working with my ideas. So I'll spend, you know, 10-ish minutes introducing my goals, and this will probably come at the expense of one of my favorite things about doing ethnography, which is telling stories. We can do that later. So I want to talk about how we understand the relationship between personal computing and economic security. So why is it that we feel that we have to learn to code or else? You know, why do we keep trying to solve poverty with technology even when we know better? This political common sense in Gramscian terms is really strong, and it persists across political parties, geographies, and economic conditions. I call it the access doctrine. So what does that look like? So these posters started showing up in DC's subway system, largely in those neighborhoods still majority Black, in 2013. Each one in the series declared, "The internet, your future depends on it," next to a photo of a working class Black Washingtonian and their story about using the DC government's digital training resources to get a good office job after a career in the service industry. So, you know, one has like 20 years as a beautician. Now I'm a network engineer. Then you text for more details. So this one on the right, Sean earned an advanced certification in 6 months. Now he upgrades computer systems for the US Small Business Administration. He uses technology to help start businesses. So can you. New skills and new tools lead to better jobs, ones in which you don't have to work with your hands. But it's not just a matter of bringing, you know, single individuals across a digital divide, a gap between those who have internet access and the skills to use it and those who don't. The dream here is much bigger. It's, you know, you change your tools and your skills and you drive the economic growth of your city and you change the communities in which you live. And that language has changed over time. You know, we've gone from like digital divides, to digital inclusion, to STEM gaps, to the demand that we learn to code, but this idea that our future depends on personal computing is at least 30 years old. So Clinton and Gore coined this phrase, digital divide, and promised to pass on to our children an information superhighway that will help them live out their dreams. They had regained power for the Democrats after a long time in the wilderness, and we're overseeing a moment of enormous economic transition. So since the crisis of capitalist profits in the 1970s, the US had rapidly deindustrialized and was now a service-based economy. The most profitable firms then as now were largely based in technology design and technology services. Clinton and Gore and their coalition presented the 90s as an era of unlimited economic promise. And they built and regulated the commercial internet in the name of presenting access to opportunities for competition. That's what access meant to them. And with communism defeated, the internet would connect everyone to a global marketplace. but poverty was still around, and this kind of gave the lie to the story of unlimited opportunity. And in many ways, it was kind of getting worse. You know, wages were stagnant, inequality was rising, those good check jobs were limited in number. And Reagan Republicans in the 80s had a really easy answer for those people and places that were rendered surplus by the economic transition, even if it contradicted their promise of morning in America. You know, you build cages, you sit cops on them. And it's not that Clinton and Gore reversed that, but they took a different approach and resolved that contradiction. So they had gotten into the White House through a new electoral coalition that took the place of the New Deal working class. So the donors were increasingly from high-tech, export-oriented capitalists in finance and tech. The electoral base was increasingly white-collar office park professionals on the other, you know, places like Route 128, Montgomery County, Maryland, Silicon Valley, places like that. One of my goals at the level of political economy was to show how this Atari Democrat coalition, as it was called, resolved the contradiction between unlimited opportunity and exacting punishment that is at the core of neoliberal poverty policy. And they did so by presenting a new technology, the internet, as an access point for competition. Those who couldn't or wouldn't log on and skill up would be handled by the carceral state, an act of economic triage. And this political common sense became so strong that it bridged parties. So Bush too campaigned against consumer internet taxes by arguing that it's the flow of information and knowledge which will help transform America. We got to keep that flow strong. Obama, of course, inaugurated Computer Science Education Week by imploring students, don't just buy a game, make one. Don't just download an app, design it. Ivanka Trump lobbied for education STEM grants by saying it is vital our students become fluent in coding and computer science. As a side note, I love this genre of like politicians like earnestly looking over the shoulder of kids towards the future. Like, I have dozens and dozens of these pictures. And of course, our new vice president, in a campaign stop in a Des Moines barbershop in 2019, asked two young Black women what they were majoring in, and upon hearing that they were pre-law and poli-sci respectively, suggested they learn to code. So the internet, your future depends on it, is then not just a story about individual economic destiny, but regional and national destinies. And this is the power of the access doctrine. And from it flows new policies, new curricula, new degrees, new jobs, new buildings, all meant to resolve the problem of persistent poverty in the information economy, this bug in the system. And there's, of course, you know, a few problems with this story at the high level. For one, you know, the jobs of the future are largely not in software development. The Bureau of Labor Statistics projects that most of the job growth over the next decade, as it was for the last decade and the decade before that, will be in low-wage service work, largely food and healthcare, largely not requiring a college degree. Of course, the access doctrine and child concepts like the digital divide or the skills gap is ultimately unfalsifiable. So even if today's technological training doesn't work, there's going to be a new technology tomorrow. And for those interested in shifting the burden of economic transition to individual workers, they will always demand new training. There have been many people much smarter than me, Mark Warschauer, Peter Capelli, Virginia Eubanks, who have disproven this common sense and shown how complicated the problem of poverty really is. But it's immune to refutation, it just doesn't work. We keep having this debate. So my main goal in writing this book was not to offer another rebuttal to a simple binary or more nuance, a new spectrum or a new second order effect, but instead to explain why we're stuck here, why this is the way we talk about poverty. And in part, that's important to me because it's clear that the real lives of everyday poor folks do not conform to this story about defeating poverty through technology. So in 2013, if you had seen those posters in the Gallery Place Metro in DC, our subway system, walked upstairs, rounded the block, you'd see MLK Library, the central branch of our city's public library system. And for 3 years, I was really lucky to hang out with Ebony, who I actually saw 2 days ago, her boyfriend Sean, and their friends Mia and Josie. They were homeless, and they spent almost every day in MLK's computer lab. The internet was an important part of their lives, but it wasn't the promised land of the future. It was just the present. And Sean said that when he first lost housing after he and his dad were evicted, the library became my best friend. It's where he made friends, where he got online to chat or play games or follow the news coverage of the Occupy DC camp that he worked on. He told me, quote, "I was always a computer man." I love that phrase because, you know, there's a whole story in "I was always a computer man." It's a story about Sean's hobbies, his friends, the welfare state institutions through which he traveled. he was not left behind by tech or by economic progress, as those posters might suggest. Rather, he used the PC and the institutions around it to build a rich and full life and to claim space in a gentrifying city that was increasingly hostile to the working and workless poor. Sean was a computer man, an activist, a Black Washingtonian, a homeless man, a boyfriend, library patron, artist, and much more. So when he says, "I was always a computer man," that's both like this kind of humble biographical fact, and it's a political statement about the security that he felt behind a screen in the library. That security is what he needed most from the library, since it couldn't provide him actual housing. That's not its job. And he largely ignored all the digital training opportunities around him because he didn't see a future for himself in that slice of the labor market. But in order to save itself and give itself the resources that it needed, the library increasingly leaned into the city's version of the access doctrine, the internet, your future depends on it. And as they did so, they increasingly made less and less room for people like Sean who didn't fit that story. The neoliberal turn of the 80s and 90s was punishing for cities. You know, they were pitted against each other for limited profits. Their institutions like schools and libraries were gutted under austerity. DC's library system faced decades of underinvestment and political abuse. You know, it employed fewer people at more branches in 2005 than it had in 1975. The central branch, MLK, was desperately overdue for renovation that would cost hundreds of millions of dollars. But it was also functionally the largest homeless shelter in the city. And librarians didn't have the training necessary to deal with this fact that their 150 computers were filled every day, not with entrepreneurs, but with homeless folks, you know, largely older Black and Latino men who were largely resting and socializing in one of the last few public spaces in the city. You know, where else can you hang out all day without buying something? And during the course of my fieldwork in 2012 to 2015, the library, like the charter school that I call Du Bois that I compare it to, increasingly embraced technology provision and skills training and the access doctrine that went with it as their mission. And this got resources and legitimacy. You know, those makerspaces and training centers that they built proved that they deserved the renovation. And it also made really complicated, stressful jobs much simpler. So librarians were often unsure about whether they had to kick out people who were sleeping or watching porn. You know, they felt for them, they empathized, they might not have anywhere else to do it. But the access doctrine provided clarity. You know, if someone wasn't using the digital resources the library provided professionally, as you would in an office, in order to add skills in advance, then they had to go. So librarians and the special police unit dedicated to the library increasingly cracked down on sleepers, porn watchers, drug sales, food, loud talk, et cetera. And they made more and more room for the startups and the new technologies at the heart of the new library. This mission to extend access and save the unconnected or unskilled is deeply felt by helping professionals like librarians and teachers. They're serious about their mission, they're not tricked. And at the same time, the structural pressures of austerity are difficult to dislodge, and the institution itself is limited in what services it can provide. We ask much more of schools and libraries than they can handle. We give them too many jobs. So the pressures are real, the mission is personal, and the prospects are quite dim. This leads to a process of constant technological and organizational experimentation in support of social mobility. And I call this process bootstrapping. And with that concept, I pursued a goal of more kind of like meso-level analysis between big structures and individual people in order to provide a mechanism. I wanted to have an explanation for these rapidly changing organizational goals. Bootstrapping is a hopeful but frantic process. It's pursued because it garners the library resources, legitimacy, and clarity to its many competing demands. New personnel are brought in, new initiatives, new technologies, new renovations. And these institutions that are tasked with what Marxist feminists call social reproduction, this generally unprofitable job of making people with specific skills and dispositions for a specific economy, it's been overtaken by a bootstrapping institutional culture since the 1990s. And this is why we feel that we have to learn to code. Because those institutions that teach us the rules of the economic game are themselves trying to survive. And this is the only strategy that's worked. They come to this conclusion because of who works there and how they're trained, because of bridging organizations that fund and connect these institutions to examples from tech and business, and because the ambiguity of their mission prompts a search for new models. And this was another goal of mine, to show how an economy that is led by tech, especially in our cities, documented by folks like Gina Neff or Alice Marwick, forces a change in the rest of the city, in the mode of social reproduction. This dynamic restructures bootstrapping institutions. It marginalizes the people they're meant to serve. You know, sleepers get kicked out of the last public space in the city. Kids who don't want to go to college find no welcome in the high-tech charter high school. And it degrades the work of the professionals in it, who take on extra duties, extra surveillance, and extra training in the name of a mission they deeply believe in, but which they don't have enough time to fulfill. And I saw green shoots of resistance to this mission across DC during my study, but nothing blossomed. And I'm happy to say, in some ways, the terrain has changed since then. You know, I'm feeling optimistic. Because in order to end this cycle of bootstrapping, you know, helping professionals have to build power alongside those who are punished by this cycle in order to regain control over our public institutions, our schools, our hospitals, our libraries, and use them as a staging ground for a broader fight for liberation. Organizing at the point of reproduction is often less of a strategic priority in radical politics, not least because that work is often done by women for low or no wages. But it is an extraordinarily important site of struggle, not only because it has to happen and it can't be outsourced, but because it brings together the struggles of workers, you know, fighting against their degraded working conditions, and the community they serve, who want to claim the space that is owed to them. This unity is often called social justice unionism. And it's a tradition long held in American libraries. Like, I love this old picture of Contra Costa strikers saying that they serve communities, not institutions. And so my final goal for the book was, for a book that is, you know, about the violence of a particular kind of hope, to offer a different, more hopeful alternative. And this organizing strategy of social justice unionism is seen an upsurge in the 21st century, and particularly in our teachers' unions, in large part to ensure that they have the overwhelming support of their constituents behind them if they choose to strike. And this began, this kind of renaissance, with the Chicago Teachers Union in 2012, when they started organizing students, neighbors, and fellow public sector workers along with their own shops. And they created this model of bargaining for the common good that exploded across the country in the 2018 teacher strikes. Like, even our AAUP chapter is now using this language of bargaining for the common good. And this sort of community unionism brings together helper and helped in a common struggle to remake our institutions and use them as a staging ground to reclaim our cities. And instead of that cruel, you know, paternalistic optimism of the access doctrine and its technological future, where this kind of vertical relationship between helper and helped, community unionism offers hope through solidarity, you know, in the present. We're in it together. And this kind of hope was visible now and again in my fieldwork, as librarians made space for certain sleepers or certain teachers helped students stage a protest, but it was rolled over by the bootstrapping process. But I'm hopeful, you know, just as hope and technology to solve poverty, you know, just as that story was actively written and made, it didn't come down from on high, the alternative can be written and made and imposed on our institutions. So tomorrow's May Day, International Workers' Day, and I hope we can leave this conversation today thinking of how we can work together to build different libraries, different schools, different tools, different citizens, a different economy, because we got a lot of work to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. It was lovely. So now we're going to hear from our three panelists, not all at once, obviously, but first we're going to hear from Dana Boyd. Dana is a principal researcher at Microsoft Research. She's the founder of Data and Society, and she's a visiting professor at NYU. She studies the intersection between technology and society, with a specific focus on how young people use social media as part of their everyday practices. So Dana, go ahead.
Thank you. And Dan, seriously, congrats again. You know, for those who are watching, sales pitch, like, it is a phenomenal book, and I highly recommend making sure you check it out in its completion. So, you know, this was such a delight to read for many different reasons, intersecting with my current work. But I want to actually pick up on a sentence from the last paragraph of the book, because in many ways, I think that it captures some of what Dan's highlighted for you and where we're seeing, which is that, if nothing else, I hope that I've shown you the story driving so much of our thinking about poverty. The internet, your future depends on it, did not appear out of thin air. It had to be told over and over, reinforced through web filters, progress reports, and planning documents. And I think this is a really salient, you know, end of the book, but it also highlights some of the work that the book does, right? Which is that we often have these assumptions about tech solutionism, that this, we don't necessarily recognize how these systems are made and remade, the role of technology in that making and remaking. We recognize that things are socially constructed, but we don't realize that it is the making and remaking that becomes the infrastructure. when we think about infrastructure, you know, of course, from, physical infrastructure sense, right? What are the tubes, if you will, if we go back to the Atari Democrats. But we also think about the human infrastructure and the social values infrastructure, the infrastructure that does uphold poverty. And I think about these layers of infrastructure because it keeps coming through a lot of the writing here that I think is important. But it also highlights in this book what it means to see those layers of infrastructure, to see how they're made and how they're connected. And as I was thinking about it, I was remembering an event that I did years ago with one of the founders of Ethernet, as in that physical infrastructure that we think of as part of the internet. And we were doing this event with a group of young people in middle school, and we invited them to ask questions. And I'm sitting down preparing for this event with this founder, a man by the name of Butler Lampson, and he starts cackling and he starts shocked. He's like, "What's going on?" And I was like, "What is happening?" And he hands me this piece of paper. And some student had written, "Who found the internet?" Not who founded, not who invented, who found it. It was this object that was just there for it to be found by someone. And he could not get over this. Like, this just, it broke him. The idea that the internet was something that was something that was just always there. And I think about this because infrastructure doesn't start out as infrastructure. It doesn't get, you know, become invisible right away. It becomes invisible. It becomes something that's just automatically assumed over time and through process. And so what we see in the accounting that Dan lays out for us is all of the roles and organizations and networks and people and practices in that making. So, you know, we had the Atari Democrats, we have the librarians, we have all of the bootstrapping groups, et cetera. And I think about the way in which they're constrained in their own making. And Dan highlighted that in his earlier talk. But that also creates these things where those constraints become themselves not only infrastructure, but assumptions where all paths lead to hell. And I think about this, again, you know, sort of invoking old internet lore. There's a, in the early days of Usenet, there was a guy by the name of Mike Godwin, and he noticed that everything that happened on the internet, all conversations kind of fell and eventually turned into a conversation about Nazis, right? And this became Godwin's law. In social science and critical scholarship, all paths lead to capitalism, right? Where you're like, oh, no matter what we do, we're gonna end up conversation about capitalism. And bless Dan, he only sort of slightly gave us the neoliberalism. He's like, it's slippery, you can kind of ignore it now. But the entire book shows the making and remaking of the neoliberal agenda. And the way in which those divides, those logics become very hard because you know that the criticism lands there. You know that the criticism is going to be connected to the capitalist infrastructures that we have to contend with and the making and remaking of that and the way that which technology becomes imbricated in that process. And I think that's where we see this moment of being able to see, and Dan is doing the work of showing and not just telling, helping us see this component. But that, of course, leads us to a much more difficult place, where what then? What do we make sense of this? Like, you know, and Dan pointed in his talk, he's like, didn't want to leave it just with a critique, because it's important, because so many of these actors so desperately want to make it better. The librarians that he's accounting, they want to help. All of these actors that he's, you know, grappling with, they want to help, and yet they're caught up in this system. And I think that's actually where we have that moment to just think about the networks and the making and remaking of those systems. Because even though we can critically interrogate where all those paths lead, seeing those networks, having to step back and reflect is, you know, a very challenging activity. And that's where I just want to say thank you to this book, because those moments of offering as a gift, the opportunity to be reflexive, to be able to see the system as a whole, is where the power is here. And so I think, you know, leaving it off to other folks, but just that kickstart of thinking about it, about those notions of infrastructure, where capitalism and poverty lead us there, because that to me was just such an amazing gift. So thank you. Thank you, Dan.
Thanks, Dana. Now we're going to hear some thoughts from Steve Jackson, who is an associate professor of information science at Cornell University, where he focuses on where new computing forms and practices meet in the material world with implications for sustainability, development, inequality, and new and old cultural practices. So go ahead, Steve.
All right, thank you. And let me just join in the plug. You should buy the book. It's super interesting, super worth reading. Let me say a few things I really love about the book, and then I'll try and fulfill my critic's role, if this is indeed is an author meets critic kind of session, by raising one question, which in fact Dan has already opened up in his discussion here in the opening, and we can talk a little bit more about it. But first of all, the stuff I really love, a couple of the things I really love about the book. The first is the decision to ground 1990s tech policy, not so much in earlier eras of tech policy, but actually as the continuation of poverty policy, which is really remarkable. That's not how we normally tell stories of tech and tech policy. And in my mind, that is in some way, like the first, for those unaware, the first chapter kind of runs through this history in a really effective way. And that flip that the book does, I'm going to tell you the history of poverty, poverty policy, treatment in this country, how we think about poverty problems in this country. And then I'm going to show you how this gets inverted and flipped into tech policy circa 1990s-ish. That's a really remarkable move. It's not a move that most people make. And it's one of the great values of the book. So that alone is, to go back to the plug, if you buy the book for nothing else than that, buy it for that. The other thing I'll say is that I really love the ethnographic comparative strategy that's essential to the book. So the doing of a kind of a side-by-side ethnography of this particular startup, which Dan didn't mention so much today, but is one of the chapters in the book. And then the case of the library and the charter school. It's hard enough to do one good ethnography. It's, I guess, exactly three times as hard to do three good ethnographies and put them side by side. And it's actually a rare thing where you don't actually see that many books that are able to do that. And it's really essential to the book strategy of calling out sort of the parallels and differences of this unified thing that Dan is trying to describe, the access doctrine, as it plays out through three separate institutional worlds with their own kind of conditions and histories and particularities in some ways and challenges. So it's really amazing to sort of see that played out through these different worlds. The one thing I want to push on a little bit is that, and Dan is aware of this, we've had past discussions around this a little bit too, is sort of the way the category of hope is used in the book. So it's an essential category, right? It shows up in the title. It's sort of carried throughout and we come back to it at the end. This is part of a larger question and sort of puzzle that I've also been thinking about. My concern here is if there aren't places in the book where we're treating hope in too thin a way, or we're giving credence to what seems ultimately a very thin, almost paper thin version of hope. So when we talk about the hope of the technopreneur, it seems very thin and easy to dismiss because it's so patently at odds with the realities of the worlds that they're kind of engaging. And it seems so obviously likely to fall short. I'll give you an example. It's not a negative example, but to try and explain a little bit about how I'm thinking about different categories of hope. This is actually just a quote from one of the characters in the book, Ryan, who's a teacher. So it's in the third case study. I'll just read the quote. So he's talking about Teach for America, how this he spent some time at Teach for America, and then that brings him into teaching, and he ends up at this the school that Dan is studying. So this is Ryan. TFA basically tells you that you are amazing and that low-income kids need you, and there's a lot of this thing that sets you up to feel like this sort of white knight that's coming in and doing great things. Then you start teaching and you suck at it, and the distinctions in race and class between your students and possibly us, depending on your background, that's an issue. So it's a great quote. It's a really interesting reflection from this guy, Ryan. What I wanna argue here is that the first part, the Teach for America, white knight stuff, that's not really hope. That's not really the kind of hope that we most need to be thinking about. For me, the possibility of hope begins where when he gets to the end. When he hits the roadblock, he realizes where things are falling short, and he's having kind of the oh shit moment. Like, actually, this is what I thought the world was like. I thought I was like, you know, white knight on a horse or whatever. And then he hits the roadblock. And then what does he do next? So it's, you know, my recommendation would be to see a little bit more of the hopes of some of the other actors. So I really liked any place I saw not only the hopes of the planners or the neoliberal promoters, but the hopes of the other participants. For me, that was like a really important balance in the book. And I would like to see more of that. You know, one other observation about that is, I think where the book does come back to it, sort of a hope outside of the hope of the you know, Atari Democrats and their, you know, their people who follow them into libraries and schools and startups and so on, is where you come back at the end, and you noted this too in the talk about struggle and resistance. I think struggle and resistance is great. That's really important. I also wouldn't want to lose sight of the forms of hope that are expressed in staying with the trouble, the ordinary navigation of the situations and the complexities of people's lives. So the form of hope I would want to argue for can include struggle and resistance, but I think it should also include very ordinary forms of getting by, some of which we see evidenced in the book, but are maybe not, they're sort of not categorized as hope so much. So that's a, you know, I'll just throw that out there. It's a wide open discussion, and but you know, this question aside, which I'd love to chat more about at some point, including after the session, I think it's a great book, and thank you for letting me read it and participate today.
Thanks, Steve. And I think we will come back to hope when after Lilly talks a bit. So let me introduce our third panelist. Lilly Irani is an associate professor of communication at UC San Diego. She's an ethnographer trained to analyze interactional, organizational, and cultural dynamics as mediated by technology. And she is the author of Chasing Innovation, Making Entrepreneurial Citizens in Modern India. Go ahead, Lilly.
Okay, thank you everyone for being here, and thanks for the audience putting in your questions, and really excited to talk about Dan's book here today. I learned a ton reading it, and I think one of the things that I wanted to highlight that was really distinctive for me to have brought into the conversation about technology was the way that Dan centered racial capitalism, or the idea that capitalism in the United States operates in part by creating and reinforcing racial hierarchies and ideas about race to make it easier to run society, to organize workers. And, when Dan said, a lot of the book is really convincing about showing that neoliberal policymakers across the political spectrum, Clinton and Gore to, you know, Bush and other Republican policymakers, they promoted this idea of the access doctrine as the kind of carrot of opportunity. And then Dan, at one point in the book, says, for those who don't refuse the carrot of the opportunity to upskill, to take classes, to learn to code, if they fall into poverty, if they end up homeless, there's no services there for them anymore. And in fact, they can be arrested for loitering or for selling cigarettes on the street and being the wrong kind of entrepreneur, as happened to Eric Garner, that prisons, police, incarcerality are the other side of the stick of entrepreneurial opportunity. And I think that's really important, because in my own research on entrepreneurship in South Asia, I also found lots and lots of examples where people would hold up examples of wanting to see something change in the world and creating a startup or a school reform movement. Even social movements were cast as entrepreneurial, but often erased were all the social relationships, the resources, the land they got access to that made it possible for them to undertake that enterprise. Or even just in the context of the US, the tax breaks that made it possible for people to pursue that enterprise. The parents and children, the parents that would help raise your kids at home while you're doing your startup. Like a lot of those kinds of privilege are left out of these entrepreneurial triumph stories. And then we blame people who, for lack of those social resources or because of racism or because there just aren't, not everyone can win at the startup competition, you know, they don't make it. So thank you, Dan, for that. And I think the other, I think where this book fits in for me and sort of what I'm trying to figure out in how we get out of some of the problems we see around us and the organization of society and the kinds of violence that's become part of it is, well, you know, what do we do if there aren't enough jobs for everybody? You know, there's an idea in Marxist analysis about called surplus populations, and the idea that as because of either technological change or the way the countries organize production, the people who are running the factories, the people who are running the industries, only need a certain number of people to keep making money and producing stuff. And there are several authors from the 1960s on, like James Boggs, who was writing about automation in Detroit in the 1960s, talking about how automation was producing the unemployed in Detroit. Ruth Gilmore has written about how that the sending of jobs over, manufacturing jobs overseas, at deindustrialization, as Dan also talks about, create a problem for California, a problem that's partially solved through prisons. Kalyan Sanyal writes about this problem in India, where there's actually a much larger population of people than organized capital wants. Too many people become a problem for government, they become a problem for capitalists. And so how do, what are the common senses that are manufactured to help us feel like that problem isn't a problem about the way society organizes its resources or capitalist organized resources, but that we're made to feel like that problem is a problem of us not being entrepreneurial enough, not pivoting enough, as Dan talks about in his book, to find the job opportunity. In India, the people that I studied, in these design studios, they were constantly tracking what are the shifting development agendas, funder agendas of the Gates Foundation, industries that are trying to expand into India. And then they were constantly asking themselves, how do I fit into that value chain? How do I pivot what I do as a consultant or as a designer to sell my skills better? And it even affected the way they talk about and value each other. They'd always talk about, what's my unique selling point? What's my unique selling point? So Dan's book's The Chance to Stop Asking Ourselves What Is Our Unique Selling Point and Start Asking Ourselves Why We Have to Sell Ourselves So Constantly. And instead, how do we fight for a society in which the things that we already are producing and the care that we already give for each other are organized in a way that keeps us all alive and thriving rather than just helping some of us and then putting the rest into punishment. So sorry, the comments are a little bit messy because I was trying to keep it short, but thank you so much for this book. Like, I see this book as a kind of act of inoculation, like taking an idea that we keep seeing in front of us, renamed the digital divide, digital inclusion, upskilling, and like being able to identify them as part of the same thing and part of the same thing that's not going to work for us. And so I hope that we can collectively here in the audience take this forward and say, okay, like how do we organize to create a counter common sense and counter hegemonic idea that can captivate us and make us fight for something better.
Thanks, Lily. So we already have a couple comments. I want to remind the audience that you can use the Q&A feature or the chat, but probably the Q&A feature is an easier way to organize it if you have questions or comments and want to drop them in there for us to talk about. But I took a couple notes while Dana, Steve, and Lily were all talking. And I think there are things that they brought up that we could spend the rest of our time talking about. Dana brought up human and tech infrastructure. Steve brought up these comments about hope, Lily, racial capitalism. Why do we always have to sell ourselves? Ooh, I mean, I want to start with hope though, because I agree. This is something that is, I think Dan would be interested in hearing more about, why you chose this framing and kind of your response to some of Steve's comments about how you frame hope when you're talking through your three ethnographies.
Yeah, thank you all so much. Like Dana, Steve, and Lily, and Jess, this is just a real privilege. Let's start with hope. It was hard to get away from on the fieldwork level, but I would you know, to Steve's comment, the thing that stuck with me, what you said, Steve, was like, this is not the kind of hope that we need to be thinking about. And I think I agree with you normatively. Like, yes, we need an alternative. We need thicker political visions, like absolutely 100%. But empirically, and I guess strategically, like it's there and it's real powerful. And it crosses political parties. It's ideology of hustle that remakes like entire cities. I mean, this is primarily a story about cities. So it's real and it's something you have to go through. It can't be gone around. I actually ended up taking this phrase out of the book because I was like, I already invented two phrases. I don't need three. But the political economy of the hope in the title is supposed to describe this process of like neoliberal urban development such that, specifically the part of social reproduction that comes into it, where cities who are in competition, you know, they're not part of this kind of national Keynesian network anymore, are desperate to lure new jobs, especially white tech workers who don't require a lot of fixed capital. You don't need to build a new factory or anything. You just need to build new real estate and new restaurants to appeal to them. Desperate to bring these people in. And so they offer them whatever they need. They remake the schools and libraries to fit the city around them. And they increasingly like turn over more and more of the city to this kind of, you know, Richard Florida kind of vision. And I think like that, you know, technopreneur hope, Lily, I think like this travels differently in different places. Like it's very much an American hope, American story, but there's so much in dialogue here with your book, especially the kind of citizenship that you talk about. And so, yes, for us sitting here, that like technopreneur story can seem really thin. I think that might just be like the privileged status of critics in part because like we're, okay, fine, we've seen it all before. But the political economy of it is quite thick. Like even if it's not the best story, it's still something that drives a lot of resources, drives a lot of change and moves billions of dollars around. And we could say the same thing about other, you know, stupid stories that we are seeing even today. Like, I don't know. I mean, there's 20 bills going across state governments right now based on the idea that like trans kids are somehow getting an advantage in sports by transitioning. And so they're like doing state sanctioned child abuse to prevent this epidemic that absolutely doesn't exist. Like stupid stories can have an enormous amount of power. And especially when they get institutionalized, like this is something that's going to generate like both the story about trans kids and the stories that I'm telling, the story that generates rules and jobs and reforms and new buildings that stick around long after the story itself is gone. So I would say that's the first thing I would say. This is a real problem that we have to deal with, even if it doesn't make sense. Like we've been saying for 20 years now that it doesn't make sense. We've been saying that as soon as we called it a digital divide. And I think the alternative is very much found in this idea that you have about hope being ordinary. And I would push back on that only a little bit to say that like I don't find class struggle and ordinary life to be totally separate. You know, in part what I see when I was, you know, hanging out with homeless folks in the library is like often, you know, in the middle of the University of Maryland, that we have this big green mall and there are lots of paths that cross it at seemingly random angles that are paved over. And those paths were caused not because of the planners did that, but because they opened up the space and they just found that kids were crossing at these specific intersections and they made the paths and then the institution followed along there. And you see stuff like that every day where people are, you know, in these institutions that criminalize and paternalize poverty and force people into these routines. Like being poor is a tremendously time-consuming, pain in the ass way to live. It's extraordinarily expensive, but nonetheless, people are making like family spaces and rest spaces and care spaces and play spaces and entrepreneurial spaces that don't stick to the script. You know, things about like, you know, drug deals or pyramid schemes or like DC oil men, that, you know, stuff that isn't startup stuff. All of that is happening on the ground. And what could happen if we took the idea that's, you know, gaining a little bit of circulation because as the Biden administration argues, that care is a part of infrastructure as well. If we took seriously what people are doing on the ground to survive and make their own space in the institutions, and we supported that and built that up as a legitimate path, we would have very different kinds of schools and libraries that conform to what they are looking for and what responds to their actual lives instead of the terms that we've set for them. So I think that's how I see this kind of stuff operating, is that like there is always a fight ongoing at the bottom. That's what drives history forward, even if it's through losses. But if we see that fight and help build that up and externalize it over time, that's what I, you know, the hope I see in this kind of idea of organizing at the point of reproduction, then I think we have the space for new and different kinds of hope in our institutions, much more ordinary kind of things.
Great. Why don't I open this up to other panelists? I know, Lilly, you want to say something, then we'll go to Dana.
Yeah, one thing I've been thinking as I've been listening and thinking through the why hope is, you, like Steve, the way you described hope, it was something that comes from the inside of somebody, and that there's a proper hope that's kind of politically generative, and then there's a kind of hope that's like really just like a deception of some sort, maybe, and we don't want to call that hope. But I think for me, the value of saying that hope can be a kind of a struggle over how the narrative of what the future is, it's not something that comes from inside of people, and it is a terrain of struggle. And like, that's what I see in Dan's book, is that, you know, politicians, you know, craft hope narratives. And if people who think that we're helping professionals or teaching professionals or, you know, like organizers, like, I mean, I think organizers recognize this more, like, you know, we are also on that, we are also engaging hope as a terrain of struggle, and like we better recognize that rather than assessing how things like as they are, or calling, you know, speculation, but not realizing like hope's the thing that we're part of, what we're fighting over, and we didn't even realize it politically. It's just,
yeah, I mean, actually, Lilly, that's great for me to jump off of, because I think that it's that narrative of hope that occurs within primarily progressive advocates of different forms that often gets disconnected from the practices, desires, needs, and hopes of those for whom they believe themselves to be speaking or communicating. And there's layers of this. And this gets to Bastian's comment in the thread, which is that I think part of the point is that it is precisely the missing of the perspectives of, you know, what Bastian's labeling as minorities and poor folk, that is actually missing from a lot of what goes on and what gets configured in these systems. And that's where, you know, Dan's book regularly reminds us of this, where it's just like, oh, here's this ideal thing. And by the way, we're gonna kick out the people in order to do the ideal things that'll help the people, right? And that keeps happening and rehappening. And I think that's where, when we get to that macro level question of like, what does the infrastructure of capitalism look like? What does the infrastructure of you know, this particular configuration of political economy look like? Those infrastructure levels allow for these emotional distancing from people that are supposedly being benefited from the policies, politic, and systems that are being built. And it is precisely that disconnect, which is where rhetorics of hope become abstracted. And I think that's where I see that component to Steve's point, which is, what are these abstractions of hope that we're struggling with? And who gets to hold on to those abstractions of hope? Who finds value and validation in those abstractions of hope because they believe themselves to be helping a bigger picture? What does it mean to purposefully be blind to not seeing how you are complicit within a system that is actually not reconfiguring the structures of power and actually upholding these inequities that everyone is supposedly trying to help with? And I think it's exactly that disconnect that I think is important to recognize here and to really see and sit with.
Yeah, so just to, I would fully agree with that. And I think that was really, really well put. I mean, one of the ways I think about it is that languages of hope confer or withdraw agency in different ways. And one of my critiques of, I think we're actually fully in line, Dan. I think the question is terminology and what words we want to use for this. One of the reasons I don't want to call what the neoliberalizers are doing hope here is because I think there are much more authentic and powerful forms of hope which keep agency at home. Whereas what the library transformers here are doing, I fear, is selling a narrative of hope that is unworthy of the name, largely because it keeps agency with them. It's not actually conferring agency on the people that for whom it claims to want, and in some ways claims legitimate. I mean, I don't want to read it. It's more complex than a cynical operation interpretation would. And I think your book does that. I mean, I think your book does fair credit to the people, even the people who are ultimately you're concerned about their positioning in this debate. I think you do them justice in also acknowledging that they have a positionality in this which obscures them from understanding and enacting, doing things in the world in the way that you or we might want. But it's a position of integrity that they're trying to enact from their own limited positionality. I think that's really important, because I think if we become too cynical in our critiques, I think we lose the social realism of what's happening in these scenes. So a really thin version of hope, I would almost want to call like the cruel optimism language, I think is a really good name for that, because I think that's what's going on here. But there's a question that we don't have to answer it now, and I certainly can't answer it. That's why I'm asking it, because I'm thinking about it all the time, is what would an ethnography of hope look like, right? Like, how would one study this? How would one study hope in this wide-ranging, comprehensive way? Anyway, if you know the answer, please send me an email, because I would love to know.
I want to move on to some questions from the audience. I don't know if, Danny, you had anything that you wanted to, you know, do you want to answer Steve's, you know, $100,000 question there?
let's see if he coughs up the $100,000 and I'll send him. let's move to the audience.
Okay, so we have two questions from two different folks in the audience that I want to read both of them. They're both a bit long, but they're interconnected. So I'm going to read through these and then hear thoughts from the panel. So John says, I'm seeing a misunderstanding or misrepresentation of the goals of computer science education here. Learning to program is not the same as you should become a software engineer. Computers are ubiquitous now, have or have not, and the push toward massive grassroots open source programming projects over the last several decades seems to me to be a pretty shining example of, quote, seizing the means of production. How else should we hope to self-organize against capitalist pressures than by learning to understand how computers can be repurposed for our own communal efforts? And relatedly, Bill asks, learning to program is important to critique. And thanks for doing this, Dan. Can you comment on the validity of a more nuanced view? I'm thinking of the ability to develop systems thinking, also called computational thinking, and similar. These are variations on the tech theme and can be critiqued from that lens, but it has validity in that these are important higher level skills, so more so than coding specifically. How might we resolve this apparent paradox? It is both critiquable and valuable. So I don't know who wants to jump in first to share some thoughts about this. Lily's waving her hands. Why don't you go? Oh, unless you want to start, Dan.
Yeah, I can start. So, and thank you both, Bill, especially. Like, I've been thinking about this as we build a new major. So I'll start with the first question and kind of and segue into Bill's. You know, part of what I'm doing is having an institutional critique that shows like the various top level like restrictions on our institutions and what they're able to do, what they want to do, even if they know it's against their own interest. And of course, acknowledging that these are like vastly diverse places. Like one of the things that I was kind of surprised to find was that like the level of belief in the thinner story, the access doctrine, is much higher at the top of the organization for the people who have to do the job of selling it and interacting with power brokers and pitching to the community and pitching to their staff and stuff like that. And those folks who are at the bottom of the organization and actually dealing with the problem every day, much less those people who are themselves labeled as problems, realize that the story is much more complicated. or at least are more comfortable saying that publicly. So, you know, to the question of like what computer science education is for, I think it's really about like who gets to dictate those terms. Like individual computer science educators are going to have a million different ideas of what it's for. But your state regulators are going to have a fairly thorough and fairly basic idea of what it is. Like it's, state regulators are not interested in the nuances of what this kind of feeling can do, what this literacy can accomplish, and all the wonderful things that it is. Like if you ask the regents of my university what CS is for, instead of you're going to, you know, work at Google or make another Google. And if you ask our incredibly stressed out, indebted students, you know, why they're majoring in CS or InfoSci, they're going to say, my parents want a return on the investment. I need to get a good job. There are very few good jobs. This is maybe the thing that's going to help. So we may want a whole host of different things for our curriculum, but the very real pressures of like stagnant wages, expensive housing and healthcare. I mean, like rent has doubled in the last 15 years. Like it's ridiculous. Like these costs are really, really real. And so people see these things as a means to an end. So we may want something different out of them, but this is the calculus imposed on us by the political economy here. As far as like whether we can have something different, like what Bill is asking about, like a more nuanced version of technological thinking that is less, you know, means to an end. I mean, I think that's what I want. And in the best days, that's what places like iSchools build, like in something that is more like what Virginia Eubanks calls like a technological citizenship. So not just the skill to take something apart, but to understand how it works in the very broadest sense. You know, not just whether your commits function, but how they work as a business, as a part of the state, as a relationship to the mechanical turkers that are, you know, doing all your grunt work. Like that's how it works in a very broad sense. And that kind of like, I guess more craft mentality, like that is something I'm very interested in seeing. And it is in different places all the time. Like there is like an upsurge in tech sector organizing that in the last decade that I would have never believed would have happened before. There are like creative, amazing products or projects all over the world that are showing like different ways of, you know, working with code. And that stuff gives me great hope. If that was equivalent to seizing the means of production, that would have already happened. You know, the fact that I know how to butcher a pig doesn't mean I own Smithfield, you know? Like the fact that I know how to knit a sweater doesn't mean I own the Gap. Like those two things are extremely different. So it's, and hopefully that power analysis of like who is able to do what, where and when to whom is also part of this technological citizenship that we're inculcating. And I think our students are frankly desperate for it. Like I get such an enthusiastic response from my students who get to teach more about like political literacy, about institutional analyses, about budgets, you know, this kind of thing. They love that kind of stuff. They do a really, really good job at it. So the demand is there, but there are lots of other competing demands and we have to figure out how to work together to solve those kind of top level problems.
Lilly, then Dana.
Yeah. Dan's setup about, you know, the difference between knowing how to code and technological citizenship, you know, I want to echo that, but I also want to give just a really, you know, a really practical example of you know, people who might know people like knowing, like one of the things that I've noticed, I have two different projects. Like one is called Turkopticon and it's a software project that we've been trying to, and we have turned over to basically being run by Amazon Mechanical Turk workers because it's a platform for them. But over the last year and a half, we realized that the barriers to workers who, the workers running the system autonomously, is not only knowing how to code, it's not even understanding the relationship of the software to the broader society and its values and its political economy. It's also time. Like, who has the time to learn to code? Who has the time to actually maintain the code? Who has the time to talk to users of the system and to understand where the system needs to go? And if you kind of go to entrepreneurship in South Asia, Prashant Rajan is a researcher who's done a kind of meta-analysis of case studies of successful rural entrepreneurs. And one of the things I learned from his dissertation that I wrote about in my book was these successful rural entrepreneurs who build like new farming implements or new kind of clay refrigerators, they all have some means of subsistence that gives them time, whether it's their wife is a teacher and has a salary, or they like live off like farm, you know, food. I think we like to forget that the means of production are time and your body not dying, which is why it's so important that Dan brings us this question of social reproduction. It's not just a question of knowledge, reflection, understanding of any sort.
You know, as I listen to this conversation, part of what I struggle with is my own struggle with this exact conversation as an experiential issue. As a working class kid, I used access to computer science as my path out of poverty myself. And I was very much touted for many years as an example, like the story of what happens when you invest in poor kids. And look, they go to college and great things happen. And I have to admit, I was complicit in selling that story until I took some moment to step back and be like, wait a minute, that is not the story of most of my peers. Why was that my story? And why? What does my story and my narrative help sell as a broader plan? And that is exactly what we're getting to with the story, which is tells us a broader plan. And that's why I started to realize when you look at what happens with this thing we call computing, whether we're talking computer science or computing literacy or the whole spectrum across these things, we also realize how they're meant to sell different promises and who gets to achieve those promises and who doesn't. So this story here is about telling people they will have access to all of these opportunities if only they comply, if only they twist their bodies and their realities into this particularly conformist form, one that I recognize, but one that I, as Lily's pointing out, not everybody can go down that path. What you have to give up, who you have to give up in your relationships and your family and your networks to shift into these environments, what you have to give up in terms of time, what kinds of perfect bodies you have to be able to make these particular leaps. It's also where I struggle because part another layer to this is like, let's just put computing in all things K to 12. And at first blush, you're like, yes, let's help people be more critically interrogative of what's going on around us. But Mimi Ito's work has shown pretty systematically that actually the most elite K to 12 schools, they get this narrative of computer science education off to elite Silicon Valley dreams. But most other people get a version of computing that actually already silos and segments them into vocational work to uphold a system. And even the stories that Dan starts out with, we are seeing a siloing into a particular kind of vocational imaginary at the same time that we're seeing the like, go work for the next Google. And so I think we have to untangle this because it is the way in which it is not just the siloed thing of being computer literate, but there's many layers of that in our current economy, and there's ways in which people are held up and promises are made to encourage people to become and very much enrolled in a broader systems agenda that's not really about their own individual benefits, but it's sold to them as though it is about themselves.
Yeah, I completely agree with you, Dana, and I think Dan does a really nice job of exploring this in the chapter in which he's talking with about the high school, which he calls Du Bois, and like just these expectations that the teachers have, and how ridiculous it is to think that every kid's going to graduate and go to an Ivy League school and have a successful career. Like that's just not how the world works, and like to me that was them just setting themselves up for failure. I want to shift gears a bit just because Roberta asked a question early on and I want to make sure we get to it. You know, we've been focusing on education and this could be part of the answer, but libraries, this was one of the case studies that Dan presents in focusing on MLK. Roberta asks, what do you see as the crucial role of libraries? Now, this is a big question, but I was hoping you could, you know, again, when we're in iSchool, so, you know, libraries are a big part of what we think about and what we do. So, Dan, do you have some thoughts on what libraries could do better?
I mean, I have a ton of normative thoughts, but I think like my first prescription is like, it's just embarrassing that the rest of social science like doesn't take libraries seriously. Like the it's ridiculous. Like, I mean, people love our libraries. They're a hub of community engagement. There's so many resources that keep the entire city alive, much less in rural areas. And it's just ridiculous that we don't have enough talk about this. There is something of a renaissance happening now, I think, and I hope that more social scientists begin to take libraries more seriously as an important part of the civic infrastructure. But it's criminal that there isn't more acknowledgement of that's the fact where all this action is. As to what libraries can be doing different, I think that it's obvious that the demand is there and the love is there for our libraries. Like, there was a tremendous campaign in New Orleans this past year to stop a couple of basically tax cuts that would have defunded libraries. And even during a pandemic, there's this remarkable organizing campaign between the librarians and the local DSA chapter to knock on thousands and thousands of doors. And, you know, for a referendum about whether or not to lower your taxes, you think is a pretty easy thing that is going to happen, but they beat it. And the libraries are going to be fully funded in a deep red state. So I think that love is there and that needs to be capitalized further. So I think like there, on the one hand, I'm happy to make like policy prescriptions and I've got a couple, but it would be dishonest to the book if I didn't recognize that there were specific political conditions imposing specific structural restraints on libraries that make certain policies more and less desirable. Like, I can name whatever I want on the menu, but if there isn't the power necessary to force that through, then it doesn't really matter. And that's why I end the book on organizing the point of reproduction in order to gain that power to force through what we want. So, you know, at the first base, like, American libraries can and should return to the wave of public sector organizing in the 60s and 70s when that first became legal in the US, and maybe even echo some of the many strikes in Canadian libraries that have happened over the last decade, and really get into ground level rank and file organizing, because people's jobs are really under threat. The new MLK, new central branch of our library system, is beautiful, it's wonderful. Still, you know, not obviously fully operational because of COVID, but there are no credentialed librarians of an MLIS on the ground floor. Like, it has been completely de-skilled. And that sort of thing is like an example of how this vision for like customer relationships that the library is meant to provide hurts librarians just as much as it hurts patrons. So if you want your libraries to last, it is going to be a process of political organizing in libraries, as teachers have done recently. And I think the support is there and we can do that. There's a lot of policies that can flow downstream from that, stuff like, in Seattle and Honolulu, some other cities, San Francisco, I think, libraries are being transformed to become more like social service hubs. You know, if that's where the people are, you bring the services to the people. So the library is also the place where you can apply for housing support, medical support, you know, food stamps, that kind of stuff, counseling services, all those things. And I think the renovation actually forced some librarians to come up with some creative solutions to deliver services around underserved parts of the city in kind of like mobile library units, hearkening back to the bookmobiles of yore. And that was cool. Those were kind of like initiatives of individual librarians like working together to figure out what to do. The city itself shut down the library and pushed all of the homeless people who relied on it every day to a industrial park on the edge of the city where all of like the, you know, limited manufacturing and like car repair shops and strip clubs are. So the city did not really try to make other spaces for people, but librarians picked it up. So I think like that's the one thing that I would really point to is like the kind of social service hub model, which is happening in a lot of places. But I want to be very clear that if we want to get those things on the menu, and I think librarian scholarship is pretty clear about what they want on the menu. There's a lot of great, you know, critical librarianship work coming out, but you're not going to get that unless you organize. So it's a matter of taking power first and organizing with your patrons, and the current structures of the profession, as with any helping profession, as with education, push against that. You know, you see your patrons as someone to be helped rather than someone to work with as a colleague behind you, just the same way I see my students. So it's important to push past that.
Go ahead, Dana.
This might be a place where Dan and I disagree to a certain degree, because I, and this is where I think the austerity and efficiency politics come in hardcore, which is that I actually think that there is a large vested interest in full dismantlement of institutions like libraries, and that the first path of this was starvation, economic starvation, and that this came and was supplemented by a form of philanthropy, which is completely tethered to certain forms of late stage capitalism, right? Like there's a reason we're seeing the connection to technology, because that's where the money comes, which Dan highlights here. But the challenge for me when I think about organizing is who's vested in having these institutions maintain, who's not. And this is where I think that the libraries for me, yes, I am completely with Lilly on this book as part of the story here. Because for me, the challenge with the libraries is I see them far more akin to the story of privatization of local newspapers, which is you do have some urban places that are very invested community-wise in maintaining these institutions. But for a lot of other areas, this is not a broad investment in maintaining it. And that makes it very tricky to figure out what organizing and, you know, calls to action can look like when dismantlement is part of the goal. So I often think of this in terms of like, how do we recognize these dismantlement agendas? And what are the grand projects that have to do to reimagine, not to save them in terms of their old school economic conditions, right? Which is what we see with local journalism, which is just like, we've got to find a better way to do better advertising. And you're like, no, you're missing the point. The same thing for me is like, well, we've got to find a better way to fundraise for librarians. It's like, no, you're missing the point. We need to really reimagine what these things are meant to serve and be able to get a broader group of people, not just the existing patron ecosystem, to really commit and devote energy to this in a different configuration. And I will say in certain geographies in which I spent my fieldwork doing, I was stunned by how much of the, you know, dismantlement of library narrative was connected to ideas, well, the churches can replace this, right? And the churches can replace this is a story of a lot of things that are social service oriented in this country, so that it's not a civic project, but a religious project. And this is the whole idea of separation of church and state, where you have civic institutions actually being really mangled in that process. So I wanna flag that because I'm not sure that organizing will get where we wanna go with this.
I would just add to, I think, to agree with you, Dana, that there's an ongoing fiscal condition that makes that outcome more and more likely, which is that we are, you know, it's just federalism sucks, and the libraries, and to a lesser extent, but a very serious extent, schools, are very much funded by local property taxes and state income taxes more important for schools. So that when, you know, the recession hits and there's more need for these services than ever because other stuff is closing down, because the parents are out of work or whatever, at that exact point, they have less to give and they have less services to offer. So that there is always going to be this dynamic of like, at the lowest point, there is the highest need. And there has to be something that we can do that is a very structural problem to change that funding formula. You know, something like the Jayapal Sanders bill for higher education that we're looking at right now would completely change how higher education is funded in the US, make it much more of a federal matter. Like we have to be thinking about that for libraries and schools as well.
Let's talk some more about money. Alejandra says the most recent federal stimulus, the American Rescue Plan Act, will provide hundreds of millions to states and school districts in theory for digital equity infrastructure, specifically access to high-speed internet and devices. How should we approach this opportunity once we recognize the harm and ineffectiveness to alleviate poverty of the access doctrine?
I'll just offer some quick context and then I'd like to hear from other people as well. So one of the things I try to be very careful about in the book, partly because this tendency really bothers me in a lot of other kind of cultural studies work, is I want to be very clear that these inequalities are real. The digital divide is real. And lots of people really don't have access to real quality internet. And in part, that is because the way the story was told in the 1990s as the internet was being commercialized, what Steve referenced as like the technology policy as poverty policy, was to render technology policy as a venue of competition, such that, you know, in the 1996 Telecommunications Act, the greatest number of services would be offered to the most number of people by completely deregulating what had previously prohibited like cross-industry ownership. So like satellite companies could start buying cable companies, could start buying phone companies, could start buying internet companies, and removing really any kind of federal guarantee of universal access, what we had previously gotten through giving Bell the telephone monopoly in the US. So there was a very concrete effort to make internet access a matter of competition in order to give people competition. And it is precisely because of that, that the US has some of the slowest, most expensive internet in the developed world. And we could have a different internet. And I think there are signs that the Democratic coalition is starting to change on this, in part because their base has changed and their donors have changed. If we took seriously the idea that this is not an avenue for competition, not a market good, but something like a civic resource, you know, and in the same way that we thought about the telephone or could think about libraries or something like that. So if we take seriously that everyone deserves to have internet, no matter what, that will require some other things like trust busting. You know, most people have one or two choices for consumer internet access. At a certain point, it starts, you know, requiring you to limit competition in important senses, in part to, you know, encourage it at the lower level. So like in my county and in Prince George's, we had to recall 90% of the hotspots that were given to kids in order to have internet access at home. Because they all came from one vendor, and that vendor realized a very crucial bug in there. But that vendor also has a, you know, a long-term contract to provide that stuff forever because they're the only game in town. So taking more seriously this offer, I think, is going to be really important. I give you another example from DC, where we, after the recovery from the last recession, DC was one of the few only states to receive like all three of these different buckets for internet infrastructure construction funds. They're at kind of different levels of the stack. And in Anacostia, the last kind of majority Black, or Ward 7 and 8, the last kind of majority Black areas in DC that were poverty is shunted to across the river away from most jobs and most services, there is actually incredible high-speed internet underneath these neighborhoods. And it's running to all of the mostly like government offices and social services shops that were built with Recovery Act money. But there was never any attempt to offer that to people's houses. And we've seen again and again that the FTC or state governments have really tried to strangle local efforts at providing broadband as a municipal resource, as something that is guaranteed to every citizen. So that if we started thinking about that in a different way, as something that people are owed instead of something that needs to be competed for, then I think that could change infrastructure at a very basic level, because those inequalities are real.
Do any of our other panelists want to jump in on this one?
I mean, I can, which is to say that whenever there are bills that funnel resources, how they have to be sold in Congress with lobbyists, with the economic, you know, gameplay that goes on, and what it looks like on the ground are often very, very different. And I find that the most creative activities on the ground know how to repurpose this by understanding what people need, and it becomes a matter of spin. And I think that's the heartbreaking part of the way we think about funding allocation. But if we're actually talking about masters of the economic condition, it is mastering the spin activity. It's mastering twisting and turning to be able to achieve the broader goals. So I think this is one of those moments where, you know, when I think the question was like, what do we do on the ground? It's like, have clarion awareness of what is needed, and then figure out how to sell that story through the bean counting processes. rather than just taking the bean counting narrative as the thing that should be operationalized. And I think that is the challenge, I think, in this whole economic arrangement. And it is certainly what makes certain actors more successful. And I think this is one of the challenges where a lot of folks on the ground, they're like, oh, well, I'm supposed to follow whatever the thing is. Like, don't. That is the reclamation of power that needs to happen from the ground up, is being like, okay, this configuration is completely messed up and I need to figure out how to take back power from that. And one way, which, you know, Dan had mentioned, was organizing. Another way is spin.
Well, I'm having a hard time seeing how the spin is different than the practices of pivoting that Dan talks about in his book, unless you have an organizing practice. Like if you do like basically organizing training, like at least the ones that I've taken they all start off with like the art of the one-on-one conversation. Like talk to as many people as you can, because like our workplaces, our institutions, they're organized to keep us talking to the people that help get the work of the institution or the company done. But to organize, we need to talk to all those other people we're not supposed to talk to. And so when you said the thing about having the sense of what the need is, the only way you can do that is actually by talking to so many different people that you're not only spinning, you're also trying to, if like spinning is based on the goalposts that are set out by somewhere else, like we need to change what the goalposts are and we need to come up with a definition of like what we're fighting for that lots of people will get out on the street or, you know, go on strike at work to achieve. And that only comes from widespread talking to each other, like mediated communication through the newspaper, through the organizer, through, you know, means that we have not invented yet.
And this is why I think you and I do agree on organizing. This part of organizing, I completely agree with. I think the difficulty that I see in terms of the next step of organizing is then to try to push back against whoever's running the library, for example. And that's what mm-hmm. I'm saying. That to me, I have less confidence in, because these are effectively middle managers in an economic system. Whereas I actually think that reimagining from the bottom up is precisely the organizing and community work that we need. Mm-hmm. And yes, long-term, you want it through political action. But my bigger concern is that mostly the next step for people is fighting the next level of management, which is what the arrangement has been set up to do, that actually guarantees that the actors who hold the purse strings and the most powerful actors can sit there watching the fight play out in ways where they can keep a distance from it. And that's what worries me over and over again, where I see those arrangements unfold.
But I do think that organizing is a little bit like it's like a muscle, it's a kinetic skill, it's like an embodied practice. It's a different way of relating to emotions and to other people. And so even if your fight is constrained to that middle manager, like getting the people together who can make it costlier for the middle manager to ignore you than to give you what you're asking for as a group, that is like the basic element of organizing. And maybe people can't fight the federal government until a bunch of us try out fighting for our middle managers. Is somebody in a university where the rent, you know, the chancellor like hiked the rent 50% in the last few weeks? It's so hard to get academics to even do the first thing of challenging the manager just right above them.
And I guess my feeling is that when the system is set up for the institution to fail, when the goal is to destroy the institution, fighting the middle manager does the bidding and the work of the elite. And that's what concerns me, that I often see, which is that fighting the middle manager helps destroy the system. And so if that's the agenda, and that is why for me, it's a very different arrangement of power in a corporation, where the elite actually wants the corporation to be maintaining and running and et cetera. But when you have a situation, for example, in a library context, where a huge chunk of the vested interest is to dismantle that just does the work for them.
Yeah, I would just say that I think this is a classic problem that like public sector organizing has faced. And Dana, you're completely right about like these like large structural conditions. Like they're a lot of the fallout that I'm expressing here is just like what does the ruling class do with the problem that we just don't have a lot of growth anymore? You know, like outside of China, we got like, you know, 1-3% economic growth every year. And it ain't like that. Yeah, Aaron Benenev's book, exactly. And it's it's just a different set of conditions from when people were, you know, glad to shave a little extra off the top for, you know, largely white families to give them what they need. And I think the way that, especially like Chicago Teachers Union have taught people to think about this is that the unit of organizing is not the workplace, it's the neighborhood or the city. And the bad guy isn't the principal or the boss, it's the mayor and their donors. So the, you know, when, and that's what it means to strike for things that are both your working conditions and your students' learning conditions, because if your students are hungry, they ain't gonna learn. So the, you know, I mean, the remarkable thing in 2016 when they threatened to strike but didn't at the 11th hour was they got the real estate investment fund diverted to fund school construction and school renovation, free meals programs, and that kind of stuff. And that was just an incredible victory. It's not something you usually think of in a contract fight, but it is exactly these turns of things that like change the game, because you've shifted the unit of analysis from this guy that's giving you orders to what are the conditions that are giving him orders. And so it's this scale problem that we're really figuring out, because I think like one thing the political economic transition has done is that it's changed the scale. Like we just simply do not have the same political scales that we had in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. And so we can't, you know, keep using that rule book over and over again.
Well, we are quickly running out of time. And I want to thank everybody who's participated in the chat or sent questions. I'm sorry we weren't able to get to them all, but there's been a healthy discussion going on among attendees. Since we're just about out of time, Dan, I don't know if you had any closing thoughts, anything that you wanted to leave us with. You know, we've been whetting people's appetites about the book and these issues. So, you know, if you have any final thoughts, you have a minute. So I'll, you know, let you kind of end things.
I just want to thank everyone. This is your really wonderful audience, and to Jessica, Steve, Lily, and Dana for coming here. This is just such a deep, deep privilege. I know everyone is really zoomed out right now. So for you to do this just means the world. And yes, to follow Dana again, I will say that Green 20, I'll put it in the chat, at the Penguin Random House website, it'll get you 20% off. Tomorrow is May Day, what the rest of the world calls Labor Day, International Workers' Day. If you're in and around DC, come join me at Malcolm X Park, what they now call Meridian Hill Park, at 2 p.m. and we'll start working there. Last year was the largest uprising I've seen in my life, and arguably the largest one in some senses in American history, just in terms of the number of people who are out in the streets all at once. Don't let that go just because there's a different name in the headlines. We have a really long fight ahead of us, and I really am more optimistic than ever. So this is a great privilege, and I was really happy to share this space with you guys. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dan. Thank you, Dana, Steve, Lily. I hope everybody has a wonderful weekend. Thanks again. Bye.